the Lord's going to help us again tonight. Just a few Sundays out of the year, you feel like you tap in.
Praise the Lord.
And I hope we're tapped in again today. But turn with us in your Bibles to Acts chapter 27. Acts chapter 27, we'll be reading verse 29. Reading verse 29. Appreciate you standing in honor, respect to God's word. Praise God. Acts chapter 27, verse 29. Same from reading the whole story, really. Acts, the whole chapter 27 runs together, but just want to take our thought from verse 29. It says, "Then fearing lest we should have fallen upon rocks, they cast four anchors out of the stern and wished for the day." Now, how many sailors do we have here that knows where a stern is? Huh? I didn't know it's the rear of the boat. Not no sailor, I had to look it up. I knew it was, I figured when I first read it, it was on all corners, but the stern, I said, that's one part. They casted four anchors out of the rear of the boat. But four anchors. I want to preach tonight on four anchors for life's stormy sea. Four anchors for life's stormy sea. Let's pray. Father, we come to you tonight. God, help us through this service. We do thank you for your mercy, for your grace, for your mighty power.
I
pray, God, that you'd anoint us and enrich us again with the grace of your anointing, that we'd minister to some needs, some hearts, some lives tonight in this service. We're waiting upon you, God, for your presence to be felt and known. And God, that we can say, surely, the Lord was in the house tonight. And Lord, I know you're here even when we don't feel you. I know you're present at all times. But God, I sure thank you for the days and the mornings and the evenings and the services we do feel you. God, that we can say, my heart is blessed, my heart is filled, the hair on my flesh standeth up because of the Spirit of God has passed by my soul today. I pray that you administer to every soul, every body, every life, and help us to realize we have anchors tonight, anchors in the stormy seas of life that we can hold on to and trust in. I pray that you'd move in these altars and meet every need. In Jesus' name, we thank you. Amen. Amen. If you love the Lord tonight, can you say praise the Lord?
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. I appreciate
thank you,
Alicia's brother coming with us two Sundays in a row, two services today. Appreciate him being here tonight.
Yes, amen.
Amen. Four strong anchors for life's stormy sea. The context we have here in Acts chapter 27, we find where Paul had appealed to Caesar in Acts chapter 26 when he stood up before King Agrippa. And King Agrippa was almost persuaded to be a Christian. I wonder how many services the Holy Ghost has almost persuaded people, almost convinced them of their need for a Savior. And convinced them, and persuading is different from being converted to Christianity and really having a salvation, life-changing experience. But it said, verse 32 of 27, "Then said Agrippa unto Festus, this man might have been set at liberty if he had not appealed unto Caesar." Amen. But God had a purpose for him to go to Rome. Yes, God had a purpose for him to be there because he had to testify before kings and before the great king that folks looked up to, Caesar. And in the midst of the journey to Rome, they sailed with the wind. When you're sailing with the wind, you can only go as the wind takes you. Amen to God. And that's what the church needs to do, is realize we can only move as the Holy Ghost moves. I don't want to move without him. I want to move in him and have his touch and his blessings. They come to a port. They come to a place. And Paul told them it would not be well for us to get back on this ship and sail on to Rome, because I see much harm and much loss coming to us. And the centurion that was given charge over Paul, Julius, no doubt had great respect for Paul because he realized he was a child of God. He realized he was a man on a mission. He realized he was a man of faith. And truly, he had had fellowship with God. But for some reason, the Bible says that he, nevertheless, the centurion, believed the master and the owner of the ship more than these things that were spoken by Paul. I'm here to tell you, I'd rather hear from a man of God than I would to hear from any politician, any master, any owner of any company. You hear what I'm saying? I'd rather hear what God has to say about the situation than any president, any official, any dignitary that don't know nothing about spirituality, don't know nothing about God, because I promise you, God knows more about you and wants your well-being to be well taken care of more than any official and dignitary all across this land. And we better learn to take heed what the Holy Ghost has to say. I know there's so much corruption in the church world today that you're kind of fearful who to hear from and who not to hear from. But we better hear what the Spirit has to say and what the Word of God has to say. And if they'd have listened, they would not have went through what they went through. But nonetheless, Paul was under the jurisdiction of this centurion man named Julius. Nonetheless, they had to get back on the ship. Nonetheless, Paul knew that harm and loss was going to come to the ship. And even to some of the people. Amen. If because they disobeyed God, I'm here to tell you, I'd rather stay right where God wants me to be and make sure I'm doing everything God has for me to do instead of pressing on anywhere out of the will of God. You hear what I'm saying? Because God knows best for us. The Bible says they went to a place and began to get into the storm, and the storm began to press upon them, and the storm began to be great and become a tempest that come upon them, a great tempest, a great wind, almost like a hurricane right in the midst of the sea, begin to circumcise them and begin to toss the ship to and fro. Great fear come in all the men. Great fear, the Bible says, that they begin to be exceedingly tossed with the tempest. And the next day, and they lightened the ship. They begin to be in great distress and begin to be in great persecution from this storm, and begin to realize if they don't do something about the ship, it's going to sink because we're taking on much water. They begin to throw over cargo. They begin to throw over things that they thought was unnecessary. I'm here to tell you, when you are think you're fixing to die, you realize how much things are not important to you.
That's right.
When you think you're about to leave this world, you realize what you thought was important isn't important to you. You hear what I'm saying? When you think you're about to leave this life, everything that we thought was number one in our lives, we find out it all falls to backseat of getting a hold of God and finding help for your dying soul in the life's crisis and life situations. And on the third day, we cast with our hands the tackling of the ship. And when neither the sun nor the stars appeared many days, and no small tempest lay on us, they realized it was a great tempest. All hope that we should be saved was taken away. Here they was on the ship. They lost all hope that they would even survive. The men there, the men lost hope that, hey, we're going to die. Let's just survive as long as we can. You know, there's a lot of folks in the church and a lot of folks in this world just about giving up on life. I mean, you know, you hear people committing suicide every day. And I realize, hey, money don't buy happiness. Money don't buy peace. It sure helps us along the way because we all need it to survive. But it don't give you soul peace and soul satisfaction. It only comes from a true relationship with Jesus Christ. I'd rather be a poor, poor, rich man. In other words, be poorest man in town and have my faith rich in love and peace and hope in Jesus Christ than to be the richest man in town and not have Christ, not have peace, not have hope. They had given up all hope to live. But the Bible says that there was a long abstinence. Amen. After a long abstinence, Paul stood forth in the midst of them and said, "Sir, You should have hearkened unto me and not loosed the amen from Crete to have gained this harm and lost. You know what was Paul was doing in the midst when everyone was losing hope? Bible tells us after long absence, in other words, he hid somewhere in the hinder part in a compartment of the ship, and he was praying out to God for God's word of advice and God's word of deliverance and God's word of power. So number one anchor that Paul had, as he began to tell them, and now I exhort you to be of good cheer, that there should be no loss of any man's life among you, but of the ship. For there stood by me this night, hallelujah to God, an angel of God, whose I am and whom I serve. So when you're in the midst of the storms of life, you can surely trust in the anchor of God's divine presence in your heart. God's divine presence in your life. Everyone else had lost hope. Everyone else had given up. Everyone else said, we can't make it. We're all going to die. But there was yet a man of God on board. You hear what I'm saying? Yes. Yet there was a man of God that took abstinence from them, took leave. They didn't even pay attention to where he went, but he went to get a hold of the throne room of God and said, hey, what's going to happen for our lives and these men? I believe he was interceding. There was prisoners. There were murderers. There were wicked men. There were centurions that didn't take heed to his first warning. But I believe Paul was pleading out upon that boat, upon that ship, for the life of every man. I don't care what place of society, what place of sin people are in, the church should always be prevailing and interceding, asking God to send divine deliverance and to save them before it's eternally, everlasting too late. You see, when you got the presence of God in life's crisis and life's storm, you can say, hey, everything's gonna be alright. Why? Because I've got God on my side. It don't matter what the world brings, what the storms bring, what the amen enemy brings. I've got God with me. When you don't have God, you lose hope.
Yes, you do.
But when you've got God, you can have hope in the midst of your deepest crisis, in the midst of your deepest affliction, in the midst of your deepest trouble. Hey, why? Because God's with me. Whether I feel him or not, I'm a child of God, and I'm in his hands, and everything's going to be all right because I'm safe and sheltered in the arms of God. Brother Vogan, I don't feel God all the time. I don't either. I don't feel him every day like I did this morning. Don't feel him every time I preach like I did this morning. But my friend, it don't change my relationship. It don't change that God's not with me, that God's not overseeing me, that God's not protecting me. Kind of like this little illustration of this mama that was wanting to send this boy to school, and it was an 8-block walk. And the mama said, I'm going to pay this teenage girl that's graduated from school, and she's going to watch you and take you to school and make sure everything's all right. And the little boy said, Mama, I tell you what, just give me a nickel a week and put the other 20 cents back and save it, and I'll be all right. I'm a big boy. I can take care of myself. And after much controversy, the boy convinced the mama to do it. Amen. For a few weeks, he walked to school. He walked home, and he said, you know, I've been careful. I'm going to pay attention. I don't want Mama to get that girl to oversee me and walk me. No one wants to be, I don't want to be known that I had a girl protecting me. And he come home one day and said, Mama, I've been safe. I've been walking back and forth from school all these time, and nothing's never happened. You don't have to worry about nothing. She said, son, you wasn't by yourself. You didn't see me every day. I was watching you from a distance on the way to school and on the way home. He said, but I didn't see you, but I was always there making sure no harm come to you. I'm here to tell you, we might not see God everywhere we go or feel him everywhere we go, but I promise you, your heavenly Father is right beside you. He's right with you. His presence is with you in your stormy seas of life. I wish, amen, we could hear from God like Paul can. Well, he's no respecter of persons. If he spoke to Paul, he'll speak to you. I don't care what the situation is. My God is more than able to see you through no matter what you're going through. The psalmist said, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Praise God for the promise of no matter where we at, God is with us, walking with us, and guiding us and leading us. Amen. The Isaiah said that his name shall be Emmanuel, God with us. Our God God is with us in the midst of the storm, in the midst of the trial, in the midst of the circumstance. Amen. I don't have to lose hope no matter what life brings because I've got Jesus on my side. I don't have to lose hope no matter what the storm brings. You know.